my shoes and out the door. 5, I'm alive. 6, 7, 8, feeling great.
Hello and welcome back to Beyond Your Wildest Genes podcast. My name is Dr. Noah DeCoyer and I am your co-host. Today our guest is my long-term friend and repeat podcast guest, James Maskell. With the soul of an advocate and the mind of an entrepreneur, James has spent the past decade sparking debate, encouraging a shift away from conventional Western medicine and towards a wellness-centered, functional medicine model, starting with the doctors themselves. To that end, he created Functional Forum, the world's largest integrative medicine conference with record-setting participation online and growing physician communities around the world. He's also the founder of the Evolution of Medicine, a community e-commerce platform which provides highly curated and customized resources, tools, products, and services, making it easier and more affordable for conventional medicine doctors to embark on a new way of managing healthcare. An in-demand speaker and lively impresario with a broad and thriving network in the functional medicine space, James lectures internationally and has been featured on TEDMed, HuffPost Live, TEDx, and more, and contributed to Huffington Post, Kevin MD, The Doctor Blog, and Mind Body Green. He serves on the faculty of George Washington University Metabolic Medicine Institute and speaks regularly on the Integrative Medicine Conference circuit. He graduated with honors from the University of Nottingham with a degree in health economics. He lives in Venice Beach, California, with his wife and daughter. Before we begin, I'd like to read James's mission as well because I think it's so very worthy. To empower and build a community of 100,000 integrative physicians and practitioners to become leaders and change agents in the movement to accelerate the evolution of medicine by providing them with tools, technology, and resources to thrive in a micropractice. Together, we can disrupt the current healthcare model, shifting the paradigm away from overdependency on an allopathic disease-centered model to create a more sustainable, preventable system. Hello, how are you today, James?
So good, Noah, and thanks for getting us started, and great to be here with you again.
You know, the first time we had you on, we had 10,000 subscribers. Now we're nearly at 175,000, so thank you very much.
No, it's great. I'm glad to see the progress and the development, and, you know, it's cool to see the whole ecosystem of functional medicine growing.
Yeah. Well, that's thanks to you. I don't know any person that's working harder in this field to bring this functional medicine, integrative medicine, the evolution of medicine out to the masses like you do, and work. Nobody works harder than you.
Thanks, dude. Appreciate it.
Yep. So let's dive right in. But I have an overreaching question that I want to ask you first. What do you see as the biggest problems plaguing American medicine today?
Well, look, the biggest problems are two together. There's chronic disease, right, which is we don't have the right operating system for it, and doctors are ridiculously unhappy. You know, those are two problems that I think have one elegant solution, which is more functional medicine. You know, doctors that practice functional medicine are very happy with their life and the way they treat. And a recent study earlier this year of the first big study of functional medicine doctors showed that most of them wanted to continue to practice until after their 75th birthday, which speaks to, you know, the massive satisfaction derived from practicing this type of medicine. And if you had more of those doctors practicing that type of medicine, you know, there would also be better solutions for chronic disease in every community. And so that's why it just continues to drive us on. If you take a step back and you look at, like, the biggest, you know, how would you solve this problem? You know, you have your podcast, and there's the demand for functional medicine is huge and growing. You know, there have been people like yourself out there, you know, making waves and getting people turned on to really, like, sensible ideas about how to manage their health. But the elephant in the room is that there's not enough functional doctors, and those doctors that are there are not affordable for the majority of people. And so we're looking to deal with that. And so the first step in our plan is to increase the supply of these doctors and teach them how to use models that make it affordable for everyone and also reduce their stress and, you know, sort of being a physician entrepreneur. And so, you know, that's when I look out at the problems, I see those two major problems, but I also see that, you know, more functional medicine is kind of an elegant solution to them both.
I just have to ask this question, James. What's your definition of a functional medicine doctor? Because there's some different ideas and thoughts on it.
you know, the reason why we chose functional over like integrative or naturopathic or otherwise is that I think there's a commonality in people seeing what they do as long as it's not dysfunctional medicine, right? So everyone's in agreement that they don't want to practice dysfunctional medicine anymore. And that was a sort of a Jeff Bland joke, I think, from a while ago. But, you know, more than anything, I think that the thing that functional medicine has going for it is a reproducible operating system that every patient goes through that allows the doctor to get at the root cause, understand the body as a system, and enter into a therapeutic partnership with the patient. So, you know, I think that, like, you know, say, for instance, like Dean Ornish would not call himself a functional doctor, even though he won the functional medicine award in 2010. But he wouldn't call it functional medicine. He'd call it integrative medicine. But what I think functional medicine, in my book, I really try to galvanize everyone around not using so many different words, but using the word functional, because I feel like we're stronger together than we are apart. And also that in order for this to scale up, we do need a reproducible operating system. You know, Dean Ornish has got his system for his intense cardiac rehab, but, you know, you can only do that system if you're diagnosed with heart disease. And so we need we need reproducible systems for all types of chronic disease. And I feel like functional medicine has at its core a reproducible operating system where you could train 100,000 doctors to practice integrative medicine. You know, it prioritizes and organizes integrative interventions in the most efficient way to get patients well as quickly as possible.
James, in our different podcast interviews and summit interviews and conversations, you talk a lot about the power of community, and you see this as crucial to getting this functional medicine army, for lack of a better terms, up and running.
It has so many different factors. So let's just go through some of them. At the very micro level, it's been proven by human social genomics, like seeing how the body reacts to stress, that relationships and targeted social rejection can be a bigger driver of health than nutrition or exercise or smoking. So like at the very micro level, it's having a serious impact. At the mega level, look at the blue zones and see that, you know, people that are living consistently to 100 in the world right now are not, you know, entrenched in major medical systems, but have really strong communities around them. But more than anything, Doc, you know, if we're going to grow this functional medicine community, you need to engage the power of community too, because there's what Mark Granovetter calls this sort of collective model of this threshold model of collective behavior. And essentially it's like it started off thinking about like how many people, if you were in a situation where there was a riot going on, how many people would have to throw a stone at a store before you threw it? Would you be the first person to throw it, or would 90% of the crowd have to throw a stone before you'd ever consider throwing a stone? And it's kind of like this external peer pressure model. There's like a threshold, and I believe that the threshold for functional medicine has tipped, where now it's, you know, there's going to be a move. Well, it's held back doctors in a way for a long time because there's been a threshold model to like not consider this. But I think as more doctors get frustrated, as it becomes clear that you need a different operating system for lifestyle medicine, as it becomes clear that, you know, that practicing medicine in an industrialized system is no good, doctors are starting to wake up to this fact, and it's happening en masse. You just have to look at the numbers of patients looking for the functional doctors, the number of doctors interested in running this type of practice, and you'll see that, you know, it's starting to look a little bit more like an exponential curve, and that's an exciting time for the industry.
Right. We're starting to hit the tipping point, correct?
Mm-hmm. Correct.
Now, you kind of answered it already, but what's holding functional medicine back? What are its constraints? Why isn't it bigger? Because it maybe hasn't been defined. The term is new. What's the holding factor or the limiting factor?
No, look, the demand is there. So like 1 million people in the year 2016 are going to go to the Institute for Functional Medicine's website and look for a practitioner. So there's 1 million people. So the demand is no problem. The supply is the problem. And one of the biggest problems with supply is that in this first era of functional medicine, which I would categorize as all time up until now, functional medicine 1.0, you know, the only doctors that are doing it are doctor entrepreneurs, are doctors that feel so strongly about it and are so feel so strongly about the the issue and have a moral obligation to practice it. And the success of their practice and their career has come second to just doing this every day. And they've worked out, some have worked it out. There's been some, you know, terrible, practice failures along the way because we have relied on physician entrepreneurship to get us this far. And that's not always been a good bet. It's a better bet in America than other countries, for sure, where there's more socialized medicine and not so much, you know, entrepreneurship generally. However, you know, it's been an okay bet so far. It's got us to where we need to get, which is right here. What we're looking at now is this new era of functional medicine, where what we're trying to do is, at the evolution of medicine, we realize where what we could do to really, you know, be to make a change is to make it exponentially easier for doctors to be successful running a functional medicine practice. So you only have to look at CrossFit to look at why this is a good model, right? So you have, you know, a personal trainer they have a choice. They can either work in a gym or they can start their own gym, I guess. And that was the different options, either be an employee or have your own personal training business, but you need somewhere to train. You have to build your own thing. So CrossFit dramatically reduces the overhead to build one of those practices. That's why it's a CrossFit box, not a CrossFit gym. Right. Makes it easy for trainers to learn how to train people in groups in a structured setting, and CrossFit takes off. And there's this many boxes, and you know, people can start their own micro gym, which is called a CrossFit box. So it's the same thing in medicine. How do you reduce the overhead so that more doctors would take the chance on being clinician entrepreneurs, or clinician entrepreneurs would move forward with building their own practice? So like, you have to reduce the overhead, and then also you have to teach a reproducible model. So we have functional medicine as the operating system of the clinical model, and the micro practice is the low overhead model, which, you know, we were only really able to see clearly because we had played the role that we had played as sort of like the media channel for the industry. We would see what was going on, we would hear about different practices that were innovating, and what became really clear is across all the innovation, one of the common innovations was low overhead, finding a way to start a practice in a low overhead environment. And that might mean that it's in a community setting, like a co-working space or a church or another medical clinic or a strip mall, you know, in a place where people actually are and not sort of in a corner of a medical building somewhere. And I think this comes back to community. It's actually delivering care where people actually are. And I think that, you know, by giving physicians a model and showing them and telling them stories of physicians that have, you know, quit their job in a hospital and come to practice functional medicine and sort of being able to help make the leap through the low overhead model is going to encourage a lot more doctors to, you know, to move across and start practicing this, which is the biggest problem. If, you know, the supply of functional doctors is the biggest problem in scaling this out. And so the first thing we have to do is make it exponentially easier for doctors to be successful in practice, because every doctor that's successful in practice will then now hire other doctors into their practice. But we need that first generation of clinician entrepreneurs to make the leap. Some have done it successfully, some have done it not successfully, but the barriers to entry are lower now than they've ever been.
I couldn't agree more. Listen, I'm a chiropractor. In my profession, there's 60,000 chiropractors, and that's not nearly enough chiropractors to serve the population. So your objectives are right on target. There needs to be hundreds and hundreds and hundreds and thousands, and like you said, 100,000 functional medicine doctors ready and raring to go as fast as possible.
That's the plan. Look, and I, you know, if you watch the last functional forum, you know, we purposefully haven't put chiropractors on the show for the first 3 years. I, you know, from 11 years of running events for practitioners, I know that, you know, if you put doctors on the stage, then chiropractors will listen. If you put chiropractors on the stage, it doesn't necessarily go the other way around.
Right.
Right. However, I feel like a chiropractor has to unlearn the least to be like an effective functional medicine doctor, because you're trained in structure equals function. You understand the body is an interconnected system. And so, like, I think there's a lot of chiropractors that are providing, you know, strong functional practices because they have a real grounding in it. And, you know, what you're also seeing is an efficient way of delivering this care now is provider teams. We have like health coaches, chiropractors, nutritionists, exercise people, and doctors all working together in a team. And so, you know, we have seen some innovation in the practice models from chiropractors that I think are valuable. But also, you know, I'm hoping that we're going to see a lot more of that kind of innovation.
Oh, I suspect. All right, so I suspect so, and I think you're exactly right. Now, there's three things I want our audience to come away knowing more about today, and particularly the practitioners that are on our podcast list. One, you mentioned it, but I want you to just explain it a little bit more, the functional forum.
Yeah, so the Functional Forum is the first Monday of every month, typically. It's a 90-minute show. We have tens of thousands of doctors that watch the show. We have 200 meetup groups around the world of doctors getting together to watch the show. My mum goes to a meetup group in Malvern, England. My dad goes to a meetup group in Cape Town, South Africa. So, you know, there are groups popping up everywhere. It's free to start a group. You can go to meetup.functionalforum.com. But what we're really trying to do is build the local ecosystem of practitioners. And, you know, you came back to what you said earlier, Noah, which is community. It's really communities of functional practices in every zip code. Because if you're a physician, let's just say you're a psychiatrist, and suddenly you see someone, you know, one of your patients achieve, you know, physical health through some other means, and then their mental health issues disappear. And then they're like, oh, this is interesting. I'd like to know more about this. I'd like to learn about inflammatory-based models of mental health, you know, some of these innovations that are coming around. You know, where's a community in your local area where you can go to where you're not going to feel weird, where you're going to be socially accepted, where you're going to get, you know, your desires and passions are going to be backed up by other people, that, you know, that's the community that we need. And so what we've started to see is that we have communities now in all major cities and, you know, groups of people getting together. Now we're starting to see, you know, people coming in, you know, organizations coming in to fund those groups to, you know, to create long-term ecosystems there. So the Functional Forum's first Monday of every month. If you're listening to this, I highly recommend the September one. I think it was the best one that we've ever done. We had Dr. Jeffrey Glad, who was sort of like the instigator of this micro practice movement. You know, when he spoke in 2014, it really sort of lit a fire to help us realize like what should we be doing to take the industry forward. And then we also had Terry Walls, who's incredible. And, you know, she's essentially recovered herself from MS, been laughed out of the room by MS Society for giving people false hope by telling them they could recover, and now has reproduced her work in the VA and, you know, over and over again to a point now where, you know, now the MS Society is wanting to see how they can reproduce what she's doing. So she's unstoppable. And she was amazing. Tom O'Brien, we had that conversation about chiropractors and functional medicine. So that was the September one. And then the October one coming up, the October the 10th, is called The Evolution of Medicine. We're taking it to DC, to the seat of power in America. And we're going to talk about functional medicine's potential to really solve the serious costs that are coming along with chronic disease. So we have Dr. Russ Jaffe, Dr. Artemis Sinopoulos, again, always looking at you know, the bigger picture of what is it going to take to reduce the costs of chronic disease, and what role will this ecosystem play in that movement? And I believe that it's going to be a strong one. And what I'm trying to set up our community to act like is that, you know, we are a solution, and to have the confidence to move forward with that sort of understanding, because as insurance moves over to outcomes measures and whatever, it's going to be really clear that for the majority of chronic diseases, functional medicine is better outcomes at lower cost, or the same outcomes at lower cost, or the same cost but better outcomes.
I can't agree. When are you coming back to New York, James?
December 5th, the holiday party. Get it down. We have the holiday event December the 5th, so that's the next one. You know, one of the cool things that we've instigated this year, Noah, and maybe this is something for you, is, you know, we decided that we were going to engage the power of the community to create the content too. So we started this thing called The Future of Functional in 5, which is essentially like a 5-minute TED talk that anyone can apply to do. And we're actually going to have a competition next year amongst all the meetup groups to sort of unearth talent in telling amazing stories that move more and more doctors and practitioners and people to functional medicine. So we've done a couple of sessions so far. We're doing it at all the live forums this year. But in December, each one of our meetup groups is going to host a Future of Functional in 5. You can record it on your phone. And we're going to create a ton of interesting content and really allow the voice of the community to be heard in a new way.
That's cool. So I'm invited December 5th.
Totally. Yeah, put in. Yeah, if you go to functionalforum.com/FOF5 with capital F's, small O and the number 5, you can submit your talk.
I'm ready for a talk, but I'm definitely there.
Future of Functional is beyond your wildest genes. I just made your name.
That's right. Now, the second part that caught me a little bit off guard, and I've gotten to read through quite a bit of it already, is your book. Let us know a little bit about the book.
Yeah, so, you know, the book is really a call to adventure for physicians to practice a type of medicine relevant for today's diseases. So it's a hero's journey. We look at the heroes that have come before, doctors who have, for different reasons, decided to, you know, to practice functional medicine, typically a moral obligation that's come as they've seen that they've been able to create health with this operating system in either themselves or their family members. And then, you know, the last stage of the hero's journey is the second half of the book, which is like, how do you make sure that you run a successful practice? And what are the elements to that? And really getting into the micro practice model. What are the technologies that can reduce overhead? What are the structures that can deliver care efficiently? How do we educate patients in a way that doesn't take all of our time and actually encourages patients to remember what they're told? You know, so we just looked out of the best practices from the industry. You know, before the reason, one of the reasons why the Functional Forum took off is that I already gave lectures in front of physicians because I knew all about the practice management before. And that's why I think one of the people wonder why the Functional Forum took off or why doctors listen to me is because we curate the clinical talent. But the rest of the time when I'm talking on the forum, I'm really talking about the practicalities of running a successful practice, because honestly, that is more what's holding back the industry than the clinical thing. There's a lot of doctors that have taken the functional medicine courses, that love functional medicine, that do it for themselves and their family, but have a day job as a emergency medicine doctor or as a primary care doctor, because they haven't worked out how to align their, you know, their professional work with their passion. And I think the micro practice model is the most likely way for that to happen.
Couldn't agree more. Third part, the accelerator course.
So yeah, the accelerator course is really, you know, designed to take practitioners by the hand and help them build essentially a practice off a laptop. I mean, that's what we're talking about here, is that you don't need as much stuff as you think you do, or you don't need as, you know, there are technologies arriving now to make it easier to practice functional medicine without so much stuff. So, you know, you don't need all of the supplements in your office if you have, like, you know, next day fulfillment through an awesome e-prescribe platform that has access to all the professional supplements. You don't need to have an in-house phlebotomist if you can send a phlebotomist, a mobile phlebotomist, to your patient's house to do the blood draw at a time that's convenient for them. You don't have to do an hour and a half paper intake if there's a technology that allows you to intake people, you know, from their own home, and to be able to track all the outcomes of all your patients, all the other clinics that are using the same technology at the same time. You don't need patients to come in for every visit if you have a telemedicine platform. You know, so these are technologies that are rapidly, for the first time ever, there's good technology that works consistently to provide the kind of standard of care that means you don't need as much stuff or as much space. You know, the biggest costs of overhead are space and people. You don't need as much space. You don't need as many people to operate this correctly with online scheduling and those kind of things too. You don't always need a front desk. Dr. Robin Berzin, who's my doctor and has like the model practice for this whole thing in New York, there's no phone number. You can't call. You do everything online. But you know what? That's like palatable to most people because, you know, people don't use fax machines anymore too because they're annoying. And you don't always have to be on the phone with people to book an appointment, especially when you know that like 80% of medical appointments are booked between the hours of 6 p.m. and 9 a.m. when the clinic's shut anyway.
You know, I have to thank you. You hooked us up with Dr. Berzin, and I interviewed her 2 weeks ago, so I appreciate that. Unbelievable.
Yeah, she's
person.
Going places. Look, it's a good model.
Yeah, I agree. I agree totally. I agree totally. Any last words, James? I know you got to run. Yeah. I know you're a busy man.
No, dude. Look, I would just say, listen, for people who are listening, you know, in functional medicine, you've got to, you know, to keep yourself well, you got to listen to these podcasts. You got to take action. The future model, you know, the key thing about functional medicine is participatory. So you can start to participate in your care right now. And, you know, I would say that if you're passionate about functional medicine and you see that it is the right move, you can play a role in, you know, in giving this to doctors. So the book is available free October 11th to 16th. Download it. Give it to your doctor. Email it. Like, this is a book that I don't care. If you download it and you email it to everyone, I really don't care. The purpose of the book is not for me to make money. The purpose of the book is to get the ideas out there. I think that what my hope is that if 1 in 100 doctors who reads the book decides to take action and build a functional micropractice, we've got a real shot of moving this forward really quickly. So I would say anyone who's listening to this, you know, participate in your own care, you know, keep the demand moving for functional medicine, find a doctor in your area. And, you know, we will continue to work to not only to bring more doctors across, but teach them how to run models like Parsley Health, where it's affordable for most people, and teach the doctors how to do it. You know, we do have some exciting things coming down the pipe, but the most important thing right now, which all of our plans rely on and all of the plans to scale functional medicine rely on, we got to have more doctors trained. And so that's why we decided to take this as our first step of the journey, which was to, through the functional forum, we dramatically reduced the barriers to finding out about this medicine, right? Before that, you had to actually go, you know, to a conference, and there was only a few conferences. Now it's free online forever. Now the next thing is reducing the barriers dramatically to running a successful practice. My hope is that for the entrepreneurial doctors that read my book, they'd be able to take action on what they read for free and, you know, start to build the functional micropractice. There's like really a step-by-step guide in there. And if they need help in quickening that process up, the accelerator is really for them, as far as like the step-by-step guide on how to change your workflow, build the practice off a laptop. That's what we've created. And, you know, we've taken 200 doctors through it. We hope to take 1,000 more through in the next little while. And it's a scalable, you know, repeatable system. And what I think you'll start to see, Noah, is you'll see more and more functional medicine options within side your employer, you know, within side, you know, certain other places like co-working spaces like Dr. Berzin's, or like I could tell you right now, there's big fitness gyms that want a functional medicine doctor in every one of their gyms around the country. So the demand is coming, you know, and I'm hoping that the supply will increase at the same time, and we're doing all we can to make that happen.
I couldn't agree more. Thank you, James. I appreciate what you're doing beyond words. I'll see you in person December 15th for sure.
Awesome.
December 5th for sure. Thanks again, my friend. My name is Noah DeCoyer, your co-host, and you are listening to the Beyond Your Wildest Genes podcast. If you like what you've heard today, please share this with your friends and family and encourage them to subscribe on iTunes. You can sign up for our weekly newsletter by clicking the links below in the show notes on iTunes. Thank you, and as my oldest son Hayden says, be awesome and never unawesome. Thanks, James.